I do this town. Step one, download that. Step two, run it. Great. There's got to be a command line way to run this. What if I want to do this without the Google user interface?
Do you have any use for a 7-foot-tall server rack?
Let me think about that one. Could, like, hang a basketball hoop off of it, right?
Yeah. Nathan's company is getting rid of one, and they're, well, he's taking it.
Sure.
Just throw it in Amazon.
It's ridiculous.
But he gets it for free, and it's in new condition.
Sure.
And it already is rigged up with a power supply and cables running up.
Yeah.
They're also throwing in a 16-bay NAS, which is like $4,000.
Okay.
You sure he's not blackmailing them?
No, they're downsizing because they suck at managing their digital department, so it's not turning a profit.
I see.
So he's looking for another job, too.
Yeah, I don't blame him.
Yeah. Well, the guy above him is supposedly a software developer.
Mm-hmm.
But doesn't really know anything.
Sure.
The guy was like, what's...
Well, I would have thought there would have been an easy way to run this without a GUI. Apparently not. So, going through the tutorials. Oh. Here we are. So, tutorial one. Here we go. Copy, paste, okay, what was this thing I just copied? So, where's my jar? Oh. How did it locate MOA.jar? I'm guessing it hasn't. Okay. Do I have to compile that? Oh, there it is. Lib. Scripts. Paste it. Take two, action. Oh. That's right, they versioned all these. So, -1.0.0.jar. Okay, that's cool. Exception with options. So the command is trying to run. It's this one. Something about my options are incorrect. Problems with the option learner caused by class not found. This particular tree class. Okay. So somewhere here. There's got to be an instance of that particular tree, or I've got to go make it. Oh, do I have to unzip that? First, what's in my lib directory that I'm able to work with right off the bat? Okay. So what's the license of this? GPL. All right. Sources and test sources. Java. This dash T option, right? Java jar list files. Jar TF. Tree in there? Yeah, there it is. That's the tree file. So apparently I've got to unzip the source code and find a way to compile it and test it and all that. Okay, so those are unit tests. Yeah. Okay, I'm gonna do the same here. How to compile everything. Have to like make an ant script and all this. Yeah, shoot. Find name star.java. And then Java C sources.txt. Kaboom. Didn't think that would work. Well. Thank you. Okay, we're gonna try this again. JarXF or JarXF that. Also get ant doc. Do I need anything else? Probably not. Probably not at this time. Ant GCJ is probably a new C compiler or something. I don't know. I don't need it. And then I have to go update my dependencies list. Okay. Oh, hang on. So I just installed it. Not run it yet. Now I run it. Cannot find symbol. It's missing all the Weka libraries. Ant library path. There we go. Okay, so we got some warnings. What am I missing? Oh, am I missing this maybe? Yeah, there we are. So we have all our class files now compiled. Whoops, not mean to do that. Fine. Oh, that's why. Okay, fine. So, that should also work. Should be able to do another build. Where's my... Here it is. Amplib. Okay. I'm missing JUnit. Okay. Suppose I don't need to have the test classes right now. Now I can go back and get my command line. Copy and paste out of the tutorial. Will fail. Wait, what's this? Oh, that just runs the GUI. That should work. Time agent class I'm running is do task. Oops, I specified class path here twice. There we go. Now I need to include other things on my class path. Or I need to cheat just a little bit. Wait, no, this will be the way to do it. Need to include both lib and sources slash... Nah, it shouldn't be under sources slash bin. Yeah, whatever. It's there now. CP multiple jar files. I use a colon instead of a semicolon. missing something. What am I missing? Do I have to produce a jar file? Jar and class files. Specify all that. Okay, so where is this? All right. Where's the source code? And what's the package? MOA classifiers trees. So I was right. The example I'm following is dated. Classifiers.trees. There we go. All right, so I performed a classification. Doesn't look too impressive without the GUI, but it did classify data. So how do I make something useful of this? What's it telling me is data here? Use evaluate frequential dash E. Not sure I follow. Let me just get through the tutorial and then worry about deprecation and such. Thank you. So what's different about example or tutorial 2? This is going to produce a model at the end. Expect that's probably going to fail, but let's see how. Oh, well, apparently the generator is a library class, although the classifier is not a library class. Okay. So this is the model that was produced from the waveforms. Task evaluate model. Let's try that out. This is generating a new model, and then it's going to evaluate it. Okay. And yeah, theoretically you could just wrap that up into a single step. Both generates and evaluates the model. Sure, I'll give that a try. Well, that's kind of a formality at this point. Ah, also do so while using a holdout test set. So it produces CSV of the test set, periodic points, say how things are classified. Interesting. Should probably cite where this tutorial came from. It's not where it came from. It's just where it's at. Where can people download this tutorial? Alright, careful with that.
Should be fine. Getting it for free, so it's the least I can
do, right? Sure.
Just gonna rent a small Lowe's pickup truck.
Okay. And that should work, right? See, the following command creates a comma-separated values file, training a classifier on the waveform data.
Yeah, so... if I remember right, that's... machine learning, semi-supervised. Does that fall under the classification of semi-supervised learning? You continually expand the data set. Yeah, inductive learning. So that, technically that's right. Anywho. It's pretty cool. Various models and such we can use. I don't really care what model I'm using at this point because I just want to do online analysis. Care to get involved in tutorial 2 at the moment, but 3. GUI for clustering task classification. Don't want to do this via GUI. Is there a way I can do this via command line? Because that would be cool. Nope. That's okay. Is there a clustering classifier at least? Pretty sure there is. Might have to break out the GUI. Let's skip to tutorial 4. The Advanced Data Mining and Machine Learning System. I mean, I don't disagree with anything I'm reading in the tutorial. Is this not what I did in tutorial 1? That looks exactly like what I did in tutorial 1. Just somehow got copied over into tutorial 4, or maybe I just did the tutorials out of order or something. But no, the yeah, that's the same tutorial numbers 1 and 4. Okay. File stream, or I can stream data from an ARFF. You join multiple streams together. I got through the tutorials. Now I have to get through the 2 manuals. We'll be set. MOA manual. Wait, what's that? Yes, MOA manual is produced months in advance of the tutorials. It's basically what I'm hearing is that, oh, this was produced even earlier. So any documentation I'm going to find is out of date. Great. Yep, yep, so I see. The Twitter streaming API. In this section, we review some of the data mining methods that deal with data streams and concept drift. This refers to other people's solutions, as well as the methodology for evaluation. Yeah, but I don't so much care about the theory. I want to get something working. I mean, conceptually, it all makes sense, but it's just not what I'm looking for. That's all methodology based. Just looking for documentation. Maybe this is what I'm looking for. Maybe not. We'll find out in another 30 pages. Impressive how much documentation there is, but most of it's pertaining to to science-y things that I don't really care about. Bidirectional interface from Weka. Oh, well, yeah. Of course you'd want to do that. Okay, but that's not what I'm looking for. So yeah, I think the tutorials 1 through 4 better cover what I was looking for. The goal is to provide a benchmark suite for the stream mining community. Oh, they've got a weblog. How about that? Frequential cross-validation evaluation. Most used evaluation is frequential, where instances are first used to test, and then are used to train. However, the weakness of frequential evaluation is various cross-validation, as it runs only a single experiment. We're proud to announce that MOA now contains a new frequential cross-validation evaluation. Oh, well, that's cool. I should put this on stream. Just capture the display. Or let's add video capture. Sure, why not? Doesn't look right. And just a plain old browser capture. Here we go. Just get this to, there we go. That's something to ponder. Be back in a minute. Sorry about that. Back here. Yeah. Neural networking stuff is fun. So I'm looking into doing massive online analysis, just seeing what tools are out there. Flip through these slides or not. That control doesn't work. Anyhow, these dudes did some research. Had a couple new classifiers. Neither of these are a neural network classifier. These still could be useful. But let's just see if I can get an online analyzer running first. This. Not heard of this before. Distributed streaming machine learning framework that contains a programming abstraction for distributed streaming machine learning algorithms. Okay, so this simplifies deployment of machine learning algorithms. Sure. Okay. Well, this is doable. I know how to read and write. Not sure what Apache Storm and all this are. S4, SAMHSA. I want to test. Oh. Okay. But this is going to have to tell me. How is it that I go, that's interesting too. Seems to borrow a lot from Weka. Anyhow. How do I deploy this? Does it have to be run on the Apache cloud? That might be a bit of an issue. Getting started. Okay, well, that's not what I'm looking for then. Documentation. So, is this dependent in any way on Apache? Fine. Understanding topologies. Ooh. Ah. Oh. Look at this picture. This picture doesn't tell you everything. Well, hopefully I would want to use things like chess game analyses and just see what patterns we could discover. Not necessarily limited to the most pronounced thing in Lee chess, which is... I mean, some people want to know, like, who's a chess master, who's an average player, and who's an engine. But it's not the only thing I find interesting. But a lot of people find that interesting, so that'd be part of this. Alpha chess? I have no idea what you're talking about. Okay, what have I missed in this other channel? Oh, I see. Whatever. So there's better integration between the MOA team and Apache SAM. Okay, I get it. Processor, content event, stream, task, topology builder. Look at topology builder. Which builds physical units of the topology and assembles them together. Okay. I mean, I know this is an incubation, so the documentation's gonna be awful, but, no, maybe this perspective, just looking at the source code over on GitHub, might give me some perspective of what's going on. Okay, so as of 2 weeks ago, there was a commit to this, so they're still working on this. Storm mode. What does storm mode mean? Local mode. Slides. Okay. Sure. Yeah. So you could have non-distributed local learning, such as has been done in Weka and MOA, which have all been done in New Zealand by the University of Waikato. But then you could have distributed learning. I mean, I've heard of Hadoop. But yeah, you want to have streams. So I guess, okay. So I'm actually not looking to do a distributed streaming learning environment. I'm more actually looking to do this. Just plain old MOA. Because I want from a single game source to be able to produce conclusions. And the game source is going to assemble all the data for us. Oh, I see what you're saying. Alpha chess? I don't know. I don't really care about producing an AI based on patterns, although that too would be cool. At the moment, I'm just trying to recognize the patterns to begin with. So yeah, I do want to use MOA. MOA appears to require a GUI. There's got to be a way to invoke it without the GUI. Just it's like you could see this tool clusters and visualizes data that are similar in various aspects. So we could already download this video. Already read through all the tutorials. Tutorial 4 seems the most interesting of them all. Documentation in terms of these two is rather academic, not helpful. You can also use MOA in a Maven project. Obviously, I'd be looking to do something newer than 2013. But yeah, if I wanted to make a separate application that could do that. Oh, here's the repo. Anyway, what extensions are there for MOA? Social Adaptive Ensemble. You have like social plugins that do that. Classification. So yeah, you could download a tweet reader and classify the tweets. Ooh. But yeah, somewhere here must be some way to use MOA from a command line with a data stream. Suppose any one of these provide an example of how to do that. Extension provides several published ensemble classifiers, which are pretty cool. Drift detectors, which are in their own ways useful. Social Adaptive Ensemble 2. That's funny. So you could potentially have a social-based algorithm. I guess it looks at a network of people and sees who's connected to who or whatever. This project aims at building an online, real-time system able to analyze an incoming stream of text and visualize its main characteristics using a minimal desktop application. That in its own way sounds pretty cool. Maybe find some way to do PGN stuff with that, but we'll save that for a different day. MOA for Android. Yeah, these are all extensions to MOA. Oh, okay, yeah, I could take a look at Grok. Breakthrough Science for Anomaly Detection. So you can get this, I said, at whatever it costs per hour to run it. Oh, it's currently not available, but maybe in the future it'll be available. So, yeah, it looks kind of cool. Ooh, oh. Yep, you have to have all the flashy ads and stuff. I mean, if you didn't have this really cheesy slideshow way of looking at the world, what would you have? Sure, it works well, but... I think what you're really interested in is just enterprise system monitoring if you're looking at something like that. Alright, so... Yeah, I think I've been through all this MOA stuff. No, the other other tab, I was looking at SAMOA, which took me to this taxonomy. And so if you wanted to do a distributed machine learning environment, yada, yada, yada. So, what was this diagram? Yeah, okay, I wonder. Maybe for, like, chess move computing, it would make sense to do S4 or Storm or something. But for actual single-stream classification, you don't need a distributed environment. Got MapReduce. Seen that sort of stuff before. Pipelining. In and across jobs. Oh, so yeah, just dependency resolution. Task level memoization. And this sort of stuff has existed for quite some time. Under various platforms. MapReduce for streams. Could be done. But most approaches would reinvent the actors model. So what's the point? Why not just do ensemble learning at that point anyway? Scalable, advanced, massive online analysis. This in particular, resist adversarial interactions. This is something Lee Chess is interested in to some extent. And trends change over time, and so you need to retrain the model as new data are obtained. Only if you work with absolutely enormous fast data would this tool actually be useful for you. Typically, you'd probably just want to use MOA instead of SAMOA. I like how with these diagrams, there's always a circle in the middle, and everything points to the circle, or the circle points to everything, or both. Just to let you know that it's all connected, man. It's a common platform, easy to port to new computing engines. I mean, yeah, some of these things have been heard about before, and there's a lot of setup involved. I suspect that using this is going to be equally difficult, and they're just not admitting to it. Short-term goals include using this tree. K means clustering. First release in July. When was this? This was published in 2013. So they already missed their first goal, if I'm understanding them correctly. Also, I don't really know why they would need some of this. Like, why would the people giving this presentation care about doing a massively distributed, parallelized streaming data classification or regression, but that seems even less plausible. I'll take a look at that Grok thing in a minute. Platform design. I've seen this picture on the other webpage I was looking at. They just have really simple pictures to deny the fact that this is actually pretty complicated. I don't know why they have Storm versus S4. Couldn't they have a hybrid Storm S4 API that's... Yeah, I don't know. Or, yeah, a hybrid system. Or maybe that's what they're aiming to do here. I guess these are two instances of the more generalized form. Available soon, trademark. Okay, so, yeah, we learned from that. They had a developer's guide. Version 0.0.1. Not just 0.1, but 0.0.1. You know, because this thing might get rewritten someday. Got some fancy fonts here. Small text. High-level architecture. There are three types of Samoa users. Platform users who need to use machine learning but don't want to implement the algorithm. Machine learning developers want to develop their algorithms on top of this platform and then use the distributed algorithm that's in the platform. And, yeah, finally, the people who want to use the platform itself for the sake of the other two. Three design goals. Flexibility in developing new algorithms. Extensibility, scalability. I mean, I don't know. You know, you call this section high-level architecture, and then you start listing design goals under high-level architecture. You think you would start with the premise of, we have a goal, and then later you'd get into your architecture to go after that goal. But whatever, this is 0.0.1. It's not like this is peer-reviewed or anything. I gotta say, though, just skimming through this, this actually looks reasonably well-documented if you start from the flawed premise that people want to use the platform. build failing. Awesome. That just means they're working on things. Yeah, it's definitely under development. They might rethink some of that. Let me try to look at this. Fortunately, I got my chat window up over there, so I can't click on the link. That makes navigating to the link just a little bit trickier. Okay, so we got GitHub. Off of GitHub, we want to go look for this new Menta thing. Even though they've already been bought out, their old source code's still out here. Made a thing called NewPick. The Numenta platform for intelligent computing, a brain-inspired machine intelligence platform, and biologically accurate neural network based on cortical learning algorithms. That's great. So, okay, they do have a Linux install. Kudos to them for that. So yeah, I could look at their wiki, which will take me to... There's got to be a way from this wiki to see what are all the wiki pages. Yeah, so creating applications has got to be one of these. This was updated just last year, so meaning they've got bought out in the last 6 months or so. Some applications you may need to run a swarm with MySQL installed. I hesitate to even go there. I mean, the whole point of some of these applications is that they should reduce your dependencies and not impose database on you that you're not using. If you only have Python, you can do a lot by the HTM engine, which lets you create a client application in any programming environment. That's kind of cool. Streaming temporal data. Yeah, this actually, I mean, it's well explained. I'm leery of the fact that they got bought out, and so this isn't going to be developed anymore, but looks like the product I was looking at earlier, MOA, is also being mimicked by Amazon, and so it's possible that MOA itself may not be developed in the future either. So they got APIs. One thing that looked promising about MOA, though, is that it didn't require you to use any particular network topology. I hope that network API here refers not to a computer network. Because I'm not looking to do a distributed environment. At least, I mean, yeah, you could make something network-enabled, and that, as long as you're not forced to run it on a network. Or just not forced to put it in some sort of distributed mode, I guess. Fluent is a platform for building language NLP-based applications. NLP stuff never goes very far. It's really hard work, and people generally don't appreciate it. It's pretty cool, but it just takes an incredible amount of work to get anything of interest done, because language is a really complicated thing. So, okay. Online prediction framework. See, my concern about network-enabled applications is that they focus more on the network aspect of it, and less on the actual science and quality of data that you're generating. They make it really convenient, but they don't focus on getting you the right data. Just the ways that you model data could be quite limited. The ways you could classify and run tests could be quite limited. But in other regards, I mean, it's really convenient, so that's kind of useful. But I'm looking to do one of the less convenient things here. I'm still trying to look into using this MOA and hoping that something positive comes of it. So just to recap where I've gone thus far, so here, oops, here I've copied tests out of tutorial 1, which were later regurgitated through the other tutorial documents. It's basically produce some random data, classify it, produce some random waveform data, classify it, evaluate the classification. Repeat these two steps in a single command just to test a classifier in general without necessarily caring about what your data is or are. And then the last thing to do in tutorial 1 was to like test with a 100,000, then a million samples. So you're doing like semi-supervised learning where you're supplying larger sets of data. These are just the tutorials. I did successfully install the libraries to run all this stuff. And so if I just kick it off, I mean, it doesn't look too impressive without the GUI, but I'm aiming to try to run this just from a network where I might not want to necessarily have a GUI up and running. Maybe I just want to be able to perform classification on data from a single data stream. And then export the results of that classification to just label data and say how interesting it is. Okay, so I've got a bug in this script. I thought this was working a minute ago, but apparently not. Trees. Try that again. While that's going, I'll go bookmark this Grok stuff. So let's bookmark that. See, did this test successfully? No, it's still going. Yeah, I'm just trying to make a streaming data classifier that can, that's scalable just for a single source. So something that I could feed it 1,000 or 1,000,000 or 1,000,000,000 chess games and it can identify and classify data. And have it perform such classification in real time and hopefully be capable of reclassifying older data as a function of newer data being entered. So it's a kind of an enormous task. Let's see, missed anything? Okay, so successfully in 2 minutes classified 1,000,000 instances of just random data. No, I mean, that's just a prototype. This isn't really... there's a long way to go with that. We see it produces a result file. So here's the column names. And then there's various data. So, I guess these results are used to indicate the learning itself, not the actual classifications of data. So it spent some time training on data. There's a speed at which it learned during training. And then there's a classifications correct or percentage rate and an incorrect rate and so forth. As well as bite size estimate overhead. So just some estimates about how much space is used, I guess. Oh, sorry. What have we here? CNTK. Yeah, I'm not trying to make something that's easily accessible. I'm just trying to make something that works for a single data source that's streaming data. There are tons and tons of libraries which try to make machine learning accessible. I'm not trying to make it accessible, I'm trying to make something that's functional. So I'm not really looking into a distributed network way of doing the machine learning, because that's the popular thing that everybody advertises they're doing, and it's really, I don't know, it's overdone, and there's no standard way to do it, and there will always be 50 different ways you could do that. What I'm kind of aiming to do here is just take a single stream of chess games that's just going to be flowing in from a single data source and output to a single data source classified data. Things about this is a good chess game, or I don't know, something doing kind of like what Zug was doing with his whole I forget what he even called it, but it just collected tons of chess games and try to identify which games are important and such. Part of what's motivating this for purposes of Lee Chess would be that people want to know, is this player experienced? Are they inexperienced? Do they play like a human, or do they play like two humans or three humans, or do they play more like a computer? That's something they care about. I don't really care so much about that, but I do care about the research and about helping people learn how to play chess better. So, but yeah, none of these, I think these are using the MOA library, but none of these are performing online analysis. So I might need to use their other product, which I think leverages MOA. They call this the Advanced Data Mining and Machine Learning System. I guess this is kind of their way of trying to, yeah, the more I look at it, that's not what I want. Yeah, I don't need a data flow engine. I just need something that performs classification and does it well. So, how do I... Well, I guess one thing that's to their credit is that this so-called Adams system, I think it does allow for streaming data and does integrate well with all the MOA classifiers. So maybe that would be where I start. And then see if I can find a way to perform that all from a command line instead, because I don't want this running some user's PC. I want this to run on a server and classify data there. So how do I do this with the data stream, I wonder? An unbounded data set. It's gotta be here somewhere. Yeah, or maybe I do have to start with atoms, meaning I can't do that on this particular server. I have to install it on my computer and try it out. MOA, using MOA from the graphical user interface and the command line. Well, yeah, no, that was covered in tutorial 1. I thought it was going to tell me something more than it said, which it didn't. There's gotta be some way to do this. So, you know, I guess I should put up on my screen what I'm looking at, which would be the screen. So I've gone to their getting started page, done all this from a server. Data stream mining, I've taken a look at this document. But this was produced far earlier than the other documentation and doesn't say as much. I think this just talks about the concepts involved. Like algorithms and methodology. This doesn't really provide examples or use case documentation. So, they've got a blog. They've got our MOA. And say MOA. Huh! Using MOA's API with Scala. How about that? I'm doing that from an interactive shell. Okay, why is this not referenced everywhere? This is going to make my head spin, but... very easy to use MOA objects from Scala. Okay. Using MOA with Scala and its interactive shell. Okay. So what's the deal? It's easy to use a Scala interpreter to interactively run MOA.
Yeah. Just do that then. No, it really doesn't matter. Although, did you check out Brickhouse?
Let's see. Whoops, forgot about the mic. Yeah, let me try some of my other machine. Would be a good directory to try some of this in. Let's put that over here and capture it back on the screen again. Oops, over this window. How do I paste here? I forget. That's not it. That's not it. Nope. Okay. I'll just copy this code a second time and paste it over here somehow. Shoot, there we go. That was the right key combo to paste it. I'm drawing a blank. How do I execute scala files? Shouldn't need SBT to do that. Using it with the scala interactive shell. Yeah. Oops, can't do that as this user. I mean, I'm pretty sure it's installed. Sure, why not? Alright, so we're installing Scala. Don't know why that wasn't already installed. There we go. Just what we're looking for. And for that to work, I've got to download the jar file, which is over here. Somewhere. Downloads. Release. Actually, I don't need that here. I need it on this machine. Oops. Keep going. Download that zip. Jeez, that's gonna take a while. So, oh, there we go. So I gotta download the MOA library. Come on. It's done yet. MV, the release to just remove all the rest of that from the extension. Actually, okay, so now we're in just MOA is our working directory. We're gonna unzip everything. Don't need the Mac OS
Well, they have an option also for a 9-foot cargo van.
Fine.
I think that might be a better option. Yeah, it is actually.
That's not the right command. Because I still need.
Alright.
Oops. Getting started. Using MOA right. With the command shell.
I think it's going to be like 230.
Hope I'm not looking for the interactive command shell. I'm just looking with Scala here.
Alright.
Wait, now I've got a.
Okay.
Where's the command? Yeah, so we need the moa.jar. So we'll copy this, paste the command here. Although it's not moa.jar, it's lib. Okay. Scala class path. MOA release lib MOA.jar. Do that test.scala. Right, so this is still missing some things from the command line. So I've got to do as I did on the other. Do you have ant installed? No. Sudo apt get install ant and ant doc so I can compile things. So I should soon be able to run some of this. So there's the command I'm trying to run. Let's just copy this and then put that into a test script so I don't have to keep typing it every time. So now let's go into the sources directory and do what I did on the other machine. Move the sources into source, move the remaining file into test, cd source, extract the source files from the jar file, and I go grab the build.xml. Okay, did I mess up? What am I missing? What was the command I used to use perform ant? Or did I just type ant? Maybe that was it. Ant. There we go. Now, of course, it doesn't know about the MOA library I downloaded, so I have to inform it. Command to do that. get the MOA library and my class path. Okay. So it's int, I think dash lib. Is it like this, maybe? There we go. So now I go back here. Okay, so that's not the only thing I need on the class path. I also need some other stuff. Sources bin. I think that should do it. Or MOA not found. Oh, wait, no. This is right. This is correct. That's where MOA streams and so forth. That's all in that directory. Okay, let's try something else here. That's not working. Let's kind of slash. Maybe that was the difference. Nope. Should be able to supply all these things on the command line. Why is it not finding that library? Like, if I were to do Java with this class path, I would think that it would work. Instead of saying scala class path such, I'll say Java class path such. Yeah, and of course that doesn't load because I'm trying to load test.scala. Scala class path have to consist of jar files. I don't need the interactive shell, I just want to use it normal way. Let's just try this, not using Java, let's try this just using, I'm not using scale, let's try this in Java. Just Java. Okay. How do I run that again? I think I know. It's just called experiments. An experiment. Not find or load main class experiment. Is there a package of this? Nope. Java. CP test.java. Wait. Could not find or load main class experiment. This is not a main class. Is there not public static void main declared in this class? There is. I haven't built it. That's the issue. Java C experiment.java. Okay, that's problematic in its own way, but I can deal with that. So to do that, I need to copy the build file over here. And remember our path. Tester is just going to be here. Sourcester is also going to be here. Now that I look at it, that looks a little bit silly. I don't actually need a build file. I just need to say Java C. The directory is this directory. Lib. As well as this directory sources bin. And we're compiling experiment.java. Right, this needs to be a class path, not that. Okay. Could not find symbol Weka core. Instance. I think my issue here is that I need to try the star to go include the jar files. Alright. Instance example cannot be converted to instance. Well, I'm making progress. So, I don't know why it's trying to create that as a Samoa instances instance. Maybe there's something wrong with this experiment. Maybe I got the wrong version of the library. In any event, it looks like I've identified a defect. Yep, so I've got to report this to the maintainers of the project. That tutorial 2 doesn't work. Where is their GitHub thing? Where did your GitHub go? Yes, I have to let the guys know they've got an issue. I can create a new issue. I got a pull request. I have to be as explicit as possible. Copy, paste. Okay. The example code provided. Example code does not compile. Fails to compile. So this isn't a class cast exception, this is a compilation error. First compiled the I need to provide duplication steps explaining what I've done so they'll have any chance of fixing this. First, compile the contents of this jar file. Attempted the following. So submit this, see if we get positive feedback about how good we were with documenting this. I'm gonna wager I was not very good at it, but we'll see. Can I edit this to make it easier to read somehow? Nope, that doesn't make it any easier to read. Can I indent it, perhaps? Whatever. I think they'll be able to parse that. Hopefully they can provide me some feedback, so So I can't figure out how to get this to compile. The point of this was to show that it was easy to integrate this directly into Scala or Java. Such does not appear to be the case. So, what's this about a learner? I mean, probably they just need to update the example. Probably it all works if you just know the right code. I'm just taking one last look through it. Let's see, I mean, is there something obvious that I'm missing? I just don't know. Something about this classifier class might be the wrong classifier. I guess what all that boils down to, so just for anyone just arriving, MOA is the massive online analysis platform or framework. It's used for mining a stream of data that just is a flow of new chess moves or chess games or any kind of flowing data. And I'm trying to figure out how to use this. And so far, I'm impressed in some ways about how scientific some of their documentation is, and even what they developed seems quite sophisticated, handling or capable of handling a lot of really complex data. On the other hand, I'm struggling to figure out how to use these tools, and I don't really want to need to use a screen to do this sort of thing. I should be able to run applications without having some kind of screen like this up and running the whole time. MOA tasks. Evaluate online recommender. Just looking for any way of processing online data that can do fairly sophisticated things. MOA has been extended in order to provide an interface to develop and visualize online recommender algorithms. Meaning if you were to create something like evaluate online recommender or make your own, I don't know. It seems to imply that it runs on a data set though, as opposed to just flowing data. The things that focus on flowing data generally focus on just being able to move the data from one computer to the other. Don't so much focus on actually analyzing the flowing data. I don't know. Like, unless I missed something. Here's tutorial 2 again. This is the one that supposedly had the Java code embedded right inside it that just run it, and it would run. Does this have any Java code I can just clip, copy, and paste and run? Oh, it's not an image, that's actual code. Here's the full listing of the code. So you can make your own classifier. I'm really not in the market of making a classifier. I really want to just
something that's utilizing code that analyzes data. Looks complicated anyhow. Scalable advanced massive online analysis is not what I'm looking for. Okay, we'll take a quick glance at our MOA. Because it should. I mean, R is a big data framework. It works with lots of experiments and data and such. And so I should be able to use R MOA, even if nothing else works. Unfortunately, it's written in Java. Oh, that is a slap in the face to... I assume. I don't know. Why would you... I don't get it. Maybe you're saying something about our data is processable through MOA? I was taking this as they made their own R layer, which would have been crazy, but obviously they didn't. Let me take a look at this, just because I'm amused at this point. What is RMOA for? Allows to interface R with MOA. I just don't get it. Why? What's the point? I was expecting this to offer some new, useful way to use their software. They stopped developing it last year. I don't get it. I wonder, did I get any comments? Nope. There's gotta be some better way to do this. Yeah, it shows you, like, there's all these cool visualization tools, but I don't give a damn about that. Yeah. Huh. So... anything else in this blog? Okay, why don't I take a look at the streams framework? Framework is a Java implementation of a simple stream processing environment. Aims at providing a clean and easy-to-use Java-based platform to processing streaming data. See, this is the sort of thing I was looking for. Huh. Okay. I expect this to just be a royal pain, but I'm more than a bit wary about what this is. Okay, what is it? Quick start. Okay, let me just try it out.
Okay. Yeah, let's get it. Install that, and that's installed. And then I could just run yourprocess.xml. Okie dokie. So quick start would be produce a XML file, copy. Let's go back into Leela mode and first process.xml. Paste that in there. Streams.run first process. Yeah, that would have been too easy. Let's see, what autocomplete things do I... Oh, stream.run. Okie dokie. Now, what did I just install? Who knows? Let's find out. Finds a single process that reads from a CSV stream and then prints out the data items to standard output. Prints out the data items to standard out. Oh! Document is moved. That's what tricked. That's why this didn't provide some obvious indication of what happened. Let's try that again. No handler found for HTTPS. Okie dokie. Let's just try HTTP. Spiffy. So, okay, you can get streaming data. That looks pretty cool. Basic concepts. So this, we basically want to have some tool for designing continuous processes that will process data and provide services. It can be queried at any time. So this doesn't actually deal with the processing layer. This just has to do with the streaming aspect of it. See, is this still going? Yeah, let's just terminate that. Service is essentially a simple set of functions. Okie dokie. So you could use XML to wire up services and such. There are no extended concepts. Let's look into machine learning or online learning. Uh, Examples for experiments can be found in integrating MOA. Okay. So, I guess what this means is that I could have a stream of data flowing in and have MOA classifiers running in the background. Try that. Where do I get the data set to test that with? Alright, well, we're just going to try it. Let's see just how it goes. So that was the first test. Yeah, I didn't think that was going to be found. Try exploring this directory. Is there data I can acquire? I don't see data. So I'm guessing some of the data were lost when the site migrated. Oh, sorry, I've missed a few comments here. Missed quite a few comments here. Hepatologist says he's gonna fix my problems. I will be impressed. I do see the link here. MOA has a CLI. Okie dokie. Where does this CLI? I've clicked on the link. I see the link. Oh. So hopefully he's unbanned at this point. As for the other comments, I don't know, I play music from time to time, but not very much these days. But yeah, I'm looking at the webpage. I've certainly been there. Am I overlooking something obvious? Like, what's this about a command line? I've certainly run that from the command line there. Oh, yeah, no. Let me show you where I started here. Here's where I started. That's not it. Yeah, no, I've certainly read their tutorials and copied their command line tools, but none of these had to do with streaming data. All these had to do with the existing Weka tool and how you could invoke Weka from a command line. And then they make claims that you can use this GUI that invokes Weka command line things, but it uses a GUI. And I've been trying to work through, is there some way to use Weka classifiers on online data from a command line? Use MOA dot jar. Yeah, now I think you're pointing out exactly what I've done in this. But is there a concept of do task for an online task? I've not seen any online task that that's executable through do task. But maybe that's the key. Maybe I just need to think through this more logically. Like, I poured through all the documentation, all the slides, all the videos, and I still didn't see anything explaining this. Right. Yeah, CLI would be a command line interface. So, I guess, like, so here they got their getting started documentation, and they point out how you can run this but what seems to be online about this is the ability to remotely, or I don't know if remotely is the right word, but you can run tasks and demand that in an online fashion that the task be done. But there's no task that's continuous and unbounded in streaming. But at the same time, they make some interesting claims here. Like, they do have a blog here which talks about online data. I think at one point they do allude to streaming. And so there's... without going so far as to say that this is the thing I want, which I'm pretty sure it isn't. I've looked at the Samoa project. It looks like that's a distributed classifier, which is online, but it's not reached any level of maturity where I'm able to use it. And their documentation's pretty awful, too. So I've got the impression it's not by the same team. Yeah, I mean, you might be right. I want to use an online data set. Like, I've got a LeechS instance. It's not up and running at the moment, but why don't we put it up and running? So I've got an online LeechS instance where people or computers can play games all day, and I can draw inferences on that game set. And it doesn't necessarily have to be my LeechS instance, but I'm just saying I want to use a massive data set that's continually expanding and find if there are any trends in the data. Like, are there weak players? Are there strong players? Are players who are good at openings, good at end games, players who play like humans, players who play like computers and such? I've got pretty good understanding of computer science, yes. Okay, so if we're talking characteristics, I can get into some of the details there too. So, without binding myself to a specific set of characteristics and saying that this will be the finalized set of things which are considered, of characteristics like what are the move times, are people doing things which are potentially suspicious, which I'm not able to talk about because this sort of stuff is not public knowledge. What's their average Xenopawn loss? What's their rating? Are they a provisional player? Did they win the game? What's the difference in pawn loss between moves? And this set of features, oh, and yeah, what is the current evaluation at any one given move number? This set of features will expand over time. It's not intended to be a rigid feature set. We can add in features, we can remove features, and the basic machine learning, be it what's popularized by other Lee Chess developers where they're looking into doing this with neural networking, or be it some other way of classification or regression analysis, it'd be useful to be able to process a collection of data which has numerous features, some discrete, some non-discrete, some, I forget the word that's not discrete, but just along a number line. So I'm trying to reuse libraries to the extent I can so I don't have to produce code, because people, I don't know, they tend to trust third-party code more than they trust my own. Discrete versus continuous, that's right. I pronounced that wrong. Discrete versus continuous is the word I was looking for. Yeah. So I'm just making an attempt to see what's out there, what I could reuse, so I don't have to produce my own library, because this sort of analysis has been done many times before. But what's unique about the analysis is the fact that it would be online, that the data set would be continually growing. And I've gotten pushback about, obviously we can't analyze the entire game database every single time that we want to classify a new game. And to that I suggested, why don't we just come up with some rules, come up with an evaluation model that's based on existing data, and we can regenerate that however often we need or want to. Got pushback that even that would be computationally expensive, and so now I'm looking for a solution that just does the analysis in an online fashion, which is kind of crazy, but I'm just curious what's been done in that field. Yeah. But I think potentially only like once a month or once a week or something you would need to produce the model. And then you could analyze new games using that older model and regenerate the model whenever you have the time and resources to do so. It doesn't seem very expensive to me. But no, they want to have some kind of online classifier, which automatically can do analysis and clustering. And I'm just trying to see what's out there and estimate what's the running time and computational complexity of such things. I mean, yeah, I've already gotten an offline classifier, and I'm just trying to see, like, what would it take to make an online classifier? Right, yeah, that's the point, is that if you can find some way to continuously produce new analyses per game and add that to the model, just kind of the... I'm just seeing if there's any third-party tool like MOA, which claims to do massive online analysis. Just seeing if there's anything that does that sort of thing, because, I don't know, about a decade ago, that would have been called completely crazy. Now it's feasible that maybe somebody around the globe has done such a thing already. But, no, what's generally popular is the concept of just making data analysis easy for people, as opposed to performing really complex things with online data processing. Yeah, I agree, it seems really complicated. I don't think this is what I was looking for, anyhow. But I'm not sure. Like, having looked at one of their examples, they have a concept of doing these kinds of analyses, but this doesn't seem to match up with what MOA purports to do. Well, yeah, sorry, by online I mean something that works with an ever-expanding data set. You're right that the model for what would be done, I'll just take a diagram here. So, got this nice slideshow. In terms of what I'm looking to do, yeah, here we are. So we'll call this a decision tree, right? So I'm not looking for anything on this side. I don't mean online meaning distributed. No, I mean online in the sense of streaming data. Something like this here. This is where I'm interested in. So I really don't need any of this. I just need an online analyzer that works with an ever-expanding data set. And I don't feel motivated to invent my own. So I'm seeing if somebody's done such a thing. And if not, then maybe I can somehow convince Lee Chess devs that my original idea, where you just periodically produce rules about who's a strong player, who's a weak player, and who's a cheater. Maybe they'll be more accepting of that if they recognize that technology isn't to the point where you, it's feasible to do online analysis. Yeah, that's what got me about this. That's what interested me in this MOA project. That very description, which talks about performing such classification or valuation. So I'm not completely crazy here. But I can't seem to find a way to do this. And in going through their examples and tutorials and such, I even identified a defect in one of their tutorials. Hopefully they'll get back to me soon about that, and I'll have some understanding of how serious they are. But yeah, another kind of cool aspect of this is they claim to integrate well with Java and Scala. And this is the example that I tried to run, and it doesn't run because at compile time, it doesn't compile because something in their API doesn't allow you to use this particular classifier with, what was it? I don't remember, but this classifier is expecting I don't remember offhand. Yeah, no, I saw that. That's actually one of their earliest pieces of documentation, and it talks about the theory and methodology of producing such a tool. Data stream mining doesn't actually talk about how you can use their tools to perform data mining with streams. It all it does is describes in theory or principle how such a thing would work. I skimmed through it. There really isn't anything here in terms of practical knowledge. Damn it, Nightbot. What's up with Nightbot? I thought that was the command. Might have to ban Nightbot here if it doesn't behave. Give me all the pseudocode and math behind it. Here we go. Yeah, I think I need to write my own wrapper around their stuff, because their stuff doesn't appear to handle this natively. And if I've got to go that far that I'm writing my own online layer, that means that there really isn't much for me to run and analyze, and it just is me more experimenting and trying things out, and I don't know, it's always easier to analyze somebody else's code than to try to figure out why your own doesn't work. But yeah, I think maybe that's what I got to do if I take that any further. Yeah, this particular streams tool seemed pretty cool, but leave that be for now. I think I've gone through all the options here. Done publications. How about that? Man, published things back in 2010. But given this team's involvement with the Project Samoa, the MOA is not only flightless, but also extinct. That's too bad. Yeah, but given their involvement with the Project Samoa, and given that Yahoo's involved in that, it's possible that the developers of this might have been employed by that corporation, and perhaps this tool won't see further development. They were really good at providing documentation about things until recently, so I had a lot of faith in them, but... yeah. I think I might try that at some point. We'll also see if they get back to me about this, where I said their example just doesn't compile. It's expecting class types that I don't have. So, possibly their example code is expecting something different. And if they get back to me about this, or at least give me push in the right direction, I'll have some faith that they're still working on this project. Not, maybe we just, use a different library or something. Yeah, okay. I mean, I could do that. Let's open that document. I had it open earlier. It's not the documentation I'm looking for. So here's the PDF. For what it's worth, I'll mention I did take a class in algorithms, competed in some algorithms contests, competed post-graduation in numerous algorithms contests, and have read through a 1,000-page book on algorithms. So it's possible I might not need to study the theory here to get a basic appreciation for what I need to do. But, yeah, I guess, sure. I did skim through this morning. Got some kind of basic grasp of kind of what they were talking about, but I think this is just summarizing what exists out there that other researchers have produced. And I'm not sure that any of these libraries that they're referring to are libraries or algorithms that I want to use. But yeah, it is kind of useful that they do provide some of the theory here. But I think even trying to look at this theoretically and come up with code from that, this will tell you whether or not or how feasible or how expensive it is to do various things. But it won't tell you when you actually write code. The performance of that code is something you need to measure anyhow. Because you might have written the code incorrectly, it might not perform the same way or at the same level as the algorithm suggests it would. Now, I mean, that's human error, I guess, but... Yeah. Yeah, don't... I mean... And I think most of what's here probably doesn't pertain to the specific task at hand. Otherwise, I would be digging a lot deeper into this. And I admit, I don't know, like, everything that they're talking about. It would take more dedicated study to understand the details and nuances of everything here. But I understand various ways of modeling data and mining it. It's like here, keywords there are just, you're going to build a network based on a sliding window of the last X examples. Pretty simple concept, that we're only going to hold X things in memory, and every time we generate a new sliding window, we're going to regenerate our model. I mean, that's a concept here. And there's other concepts. We could monitor the quality of old search decisions with respect to a sliding window and do fancy things based on how good our predictions in the past have been, maybe adjust how large the window is. Obviously, I'm taking... This is like a 10,000-foot view of what they're discussing, and I'm not getting into all the details of it. But I'll just say, like, actually, if I can, by way of example here, depth-first search. If you haven't seen this, it's pretty funny. So, it's because of this sort of thing. This is one I want to avoid doing when I'm talking with Lee Chess developers. They have a different perspective about things. And so, just to get things done, doesn't necessary to completely understand what's going on so much as it is to help push the discussion into the right direction so things will actually get done. So, I mean, doing depth-first search can be fun from an academic point of view, but I don't know, you get really focused and concentrated on one point and not worried about the larger picture from their point of view. And vice versa, they do that sort of thing sometimes too. Everybody's human. If there's something in here that looks viable or feasible, this initial concept of we'll hold X things in memory and we'll only perform computation about the most X recent things, it's about as simple as it can get, and I'm pretty sure that I've gotten pushback even on very similar concepts, although not specifically mentioning this, and not specifically mentioning we're only going to look at X games, but they want something that's online, but they don't want to deal with the reality that that's going to be complex. And I'm not going to get into being more critical of their specific opinions and ideas at this point, but...
I just brought up the autonomous vehicles that drive with safety level proportional to how polite you are to the car.
That's an interesting concept.
You better not be mean. It's always listening. Don't call it stupid. It knows what it's doing.
Mm-hmm.
It's going to scare you.
Yeah.
I'll be back.
That's a lawsuit waiting to happen.
Yeah, but it's definitely a great idea.
So So yeah, I don't want to focus too heavily on the theory, although I could write my own wrapper based on the theory, but I'm pretty sure even if I bothered with such a thing, it'd probably get brushed off as we don't understand how complex that is. And until you can prove it to us that that's simple, we're not going to go with it. It's too math heavy, too theory heavy, too we just don't understand it. But yeah, the theory behind this is awesome theory. It's really complex stuff, but I don't know, I'm just attempting to look at what other developers have done and being able to leverage what's out there and say, look, this is proven to have worked. This is something that's heavily embraced, as opposed to coming at this from a theory point of view and saying this is the right way to do this and presenting all the objective arguments. It's a lot easier to present case studies and other things where other examples where a project or platform or such has proven successful. It's all really great theory. I don't claim to understand parts of it. And by parts, I mean I'm skimming through it, and I'm just at this point trying to understand, is there anything that immediately appeals to me about this? And I think, useful to keep in the back of my mind as something that I might want to examine at some point. But I'm not motivated to go write my own wrappers based on this. And I expect that wrappers that have already been written, not necessarily for some of these learning things where the data set keeps expanding, but for the other wrappers, those are pretty high quality and are used in many contexts, and I've used them before for other purposes. Has a streams handling package. I'm not sure if by that you're referring to what I was looking at a minute ago. Maybe you are. But maybe you're referring to something I haven't found. Like, I found this thing they call the streams framework. I'm pretty sure you're not referring to this, because you might have used the word framework or something if you were referring to this. You're probably actually referring to a Java package. Oh, by the way, I haven't pointed this out yet, but I do just leave this instance up and running, so it's just like running all the time, which is kind of fun. But they have a streams handling package, so they have some way of being able to handle data that just flows in and gets classified, I guess. Yeah. Oh, thank you. Yeah, I had to kick Nightbot around a bit. But I think it listened at this time. Interesting. MOA.streams. Yeah. I think so. I think this is the useful integration point that I'd want to use. It's the best that MOA has to offer anyhow. And incidentally, I think this is the code which is used in the example that I filed in my bug report. Now, I might not have used the class correctly, but this refers to the code in example 2, or tutorial 2. Yeah, so this refers to the thing where... Oh, okay, so I'm... Where's the stream come from? Where did that come from? Oh, RBF generator. So, I mean, everything is stream-based here. But, yeah, that stream's API would allow me to use things like an instances stream, where I could just pass in each feature set as a new instance, and then have that feature set be classified. So it provides a abstract data point, or I'm sorry, just a provides an API by which we can feed in data, easily get it classified, and use an online classifier. And this way, there's less chance of writing your own error-prone code, and more chance of using somebody else's code, which may or may not have errors in it, but the less code that you write and the more that you reuse from widely accepted libraries, the more standardized your code is and the more likely it is that it'll integrate well with other tools, as well as improvements to third-party libraries in the future. But mainly, I'm just avoiding writing my own code, which could have some subtle flaw or defect. I'm trying to be as transparent as possible. Ah, interesting question, Kaz. That's not the case. I've done the best I can to balance the AIs, so they will draw or win occasionally, unexpectedly, against each other. Yeah. No, I think you're right. I'm pretty sure you're right, Capitologist. So, I think that's the path I'm going to go down. I would be going down there right now, except I've been researching into this sort of stuff for quite some time this morning. And I'm also kind of hoping for some feedback here, just in case I'm missing something obvious. Not that you guys have to worry about it, but I'm just hoping that the developers of MOA will take some time and look at this and let me know just if I have any idea what I'm talking about. But yeah, I think you're right that using that Streams API makes sense. So I copied all these examples into my script. The stream data, or a data stream classification cycle, where you get training examples, input requirements, learning, modeling, and just continuously remodeling, providing more training examples, and yielding more predictions. So, it's kind of the idea, but with an ever-expanding data set. Separately, just if I can get off that, unfortunately, I do want to leave that topic and try moving to something else at this point. Found this thing, stream sentiment analysis. I did say I wanted to come back to this at some point. Project aims at building an online real-time system able to analyze an incoming stream of text and visualize its main characteristics. I'm just curious. Yeah, obviously it's under development, meaning it's never going to be done. Although they'll prototype some things. But I'm just curious, what do they think are attributes in human language? What do they think is just worth visualizing? Is there some feature set or something that they... Okay. Well. So they got a thing like a keyword filter.
Okay. Not sure I understand any of that. Is there a readme? Ah, here it is. Maybe I should have started there. Phew. Sure, let's turn on word wrap since apparently this launched in Notepad. So this talks about language. It appears on Twitter. And what's worth visualizing. I was just kind of hoping that they'd provide some source code and explain what they were doing. I don't really care so much about the result as in this case is about what it is they were thinking about. But I guess that's top secret. I guess we'll never know. Bummer. I guess this just builds upon MOA. And you can write your own experiments. Wait, there's an instruction manual. Okay, this is what I was looking for. Forget the download. There's the contents of the README. First time you run it, you will need a PIN number to get an authorization access token. Yeah, so I guess you have to write your own classifier, right? Yeah, so... This is all gesturing. Really isn't much substance to it. Bummer. Gives you a pseudocode implementation of adaptive window sliding. And then using that as input for an adaptive huffing tree, just a decision tree that can't, that can be customized. Yep. Yeah, it'd be really cool to... So, MOA, MOA, however you want to say that, seems pretty good. Weka, which is the layer which does all this classification and decision tree and everything, is just absolutely phenomenal and really well documented. MOA's, okay, it's attempting to make Weka more accessible for different purposes. For online analysis, and they're really pushing their limits, and perhaps, I don't know if MOA itself is that useful, but yeah, using the Weka classifiers and such is pretty amazing. Here's... Oh. Huh. This is different than the thing that I used in my test. Let me go back here for a second and see what it was that I was testing. Okay, so now I was just using a basic... I don't even know how to pronounce that tree, but I was using the basic version of that tree. Apparently there's an adaptive form of it, which I guess lets you somehow specify something. And I'm, let's see, what would you use this for? Get purpose string. Get votes. I mean, a customizable learning or decision tree is pretty cool. Because that way you'd be able to customize the tree itself instead of adding additional features to the feature set, which are calculated features. You can have calculations done within the decision tree itself. I assume.
This adaptive tree uses AdWin to monitor performance of branches on the tree and to replace them with new branches when their accuracy decreases if new branches are more accurate. Okay. So it's like a multi-modeling tree, but why is it called adaptive? Oh. I mean, wonder what's the utility of such a thing? Oh. Huh. Let me see if I can get that up on my display here. What's the purpose of this? And here's all the public member functions. So you train on an instance, filter instance to leaves, get votes for instance. So okay, this is just producing the results. So it's really these middle two methods which provide any kind of flexibility. So you can say train this on some instance, filter instance to leaves. I mean, wait, I can expand this. Monitor performance of branches on the tree and to replace the branches with new branches when their accuracy decreases if the new branches are more accurate. See details here. Oh. Okay. This is something I can access. It's behind the springs. Springer, data source, a methodology for adaptive stream mining. I can adaptively learn from data streams that drift over time. Is to build two new methods that deal with distribution drift and concept drift. Is this the right paper? Adaptive parameter-free learning from evolving data streams. I'm going to say that this either is the paper... No, this is in... This must have been a prequel to the paper. Because this one's 12, 13 pages, and the other one is 73 pages. So this must be a draft of some sort. But what do they mean by adaptive? Let's just search. If I search for adapt. In fact, search for adaptive tree. Hopefully they'll talk a little bit about that in this paper. Yeah, that may well be the case. You're probably right. I'm being kind of naively optimistic, and that is my last resort, as I just fall back and write my own. You're probably right. Sorry, I don't mean to pressure anybody watching this into thinking they need to provide all the answers, because, I mean, part of this is just learning what's out there. I mean, I don't worry for my sake is basically what I'm trying to say. general ideas, so this doesn't need a fixed size. This doesn't need a sliding window. Somehow this is an adaptive tree regardless. Propose a new method. A general idea is simple. Place instances of estimators at each node. Okay, so place instances of estimators, frequency statistics at every node, replacing each n ijk with an instance aijk of an estimator. The advantage is that all the relevant statistics are kept in the nodes themselves, so there's no need. Oh, yeah. It's not like there's one sliding window or there's one fixed size or optimal size. Each node can make decisions about its own tree or subtree.